Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt. And that's a 2022 Corvette Stingray Coupe, 6.2-liter V8 engine, 490 horsepower, 470 pound-feet of torque, all mated to and controlled by an 8-speed automatic dual-clutch transmission. That exterior color, which I love, and so many people love. Even had a couple of people come knock on my door. They wanted to take a look at this thing. It's called a caffeine metallic. Interior color is called natural. It's 16 miles per gallon city, 24 highway, 19 combined. This model has an MSRP of $84,475. And most of the panelists on here can get two his and hers version. Couple things that I like about this car, obviously the color is just unbelievable. It's different. You don't see many of them out there, that particular color. Corvette has really improved the ride quality of the jet. People always ask when they see me in one, does it still bounce you around? Is it still a rough ride? I have to say no. I agree with most of the people who bought Corvettes. You do get, it is a rough ride, but this is a new magnetically controlled system in the vet, which gives you an extremely comfortable ride. Even going over the tracks in the hood, guys, it didn't bounce me up and out of the car through that roof panel that's removable. As you can see, it has a very, very distinctive look. It's not going to look like anything on the highway. I actually had one guy to ask if he was crossing the street, is that a Ferrari? I said, no, that's a Corvette, brother. He said, oh, Corvette? I said, yeah. The other thing is, it is extremely fast, so you have to put it on cruise control, take your big foot off the gas, and just set it at about 55 miles per hour and enjoy it. One of the things that I guess it's not a con, because it's not supposed to have a lot of storage space, but you don't get a lot of storage space in this new Corvette. One of the other things, when I shoot a lot of video of cars, most of the time I don't read the manual to see how you're supposed to do things. And this has a removable roof panel. And later on in the video, you'll see me trying to remove the roof panel. And a lot of times I get comments on some of my videos and people talking about, it's easy, you do this, this, and this. But when I go into a car, I want to see if I can do things without having to pick up the manual. You know, it should be so intuitive and easy to do that anybody can jump in, even with my low IQ, and figure it out. So, but anyway, what do you guys think about a vet? You been in one yet, the new one?
All I can do is drool. No, we haven't been fortunate enough to see one. If they have had them in the Atlanta area, they haven't made it to my front door yet. You got to give Chevrolet credit. They made it a mid-engine vehicle. They really have stepped it up in terms of quality and features. And the thing is about the storage area, if you can afford a Corvette, you just ship yourself ahead of you. You don't care.
You're probably right. But I mean, this, I have to give it to them. This is one gorgeous automobile. And if you've heard me talk about vets in the past, I have not been a Corvette fan, mainly because of the older vets and how poorly they treated the owners in terms of ride quality and just quality overall. You know, they were leaking, rattling, squeaking, you name it. But this is a car that I could own. And it's a daily driver, as far as I'm concerned.
You know, I'm probably one of the few people who walking around. First of all, let me say, I've never driven it. I've seen a few. And I'm one of the few people walking around who probably don't like it. And the reason I don't like it is that I can see the design specifications they were saddled with, because there's no way they could have put out the Corvette that didn't look like the old Corvette. So basically, they were saddled with producing a mid-engine car that looked like a front-engine car. I am still reserving judgment to see how it drives. You know, because a lot of times, you know, I see things, and my take on the way they look goes right out the window, depending on the driving dynamics. So I'm not knocking the car. What I'm saying is that I need to see how it drives. You know, get into it and see how it drives. It looks great, and they did a fantastic job of making this car look like a front-wheel drive car. I mean, a front-engine car. You know, because unless you take a real hard look, if you just catch a glance of a new versus an old Corvette out the corner of your eye, you can't tell them apart. And that is that's a testament to excellent design and excellent engineering.
Well, in terms of the how it rides and how it handles, it is great. I mean, like I said, well, this could be a daily driver. I know it's my opinion, Frank.
Thank you.
That's what I like about this show. Go ahead, Dave.
It's been about a year since I had one. And enjoyed the driving experience very much. Amazing value for 60 to 80 grand. It's a huge amount of car for that money. It's not my type of car because the footprint's a little bit big. But in every other respect, kudos to GM for producing it and selling it as well as they've been selling it.
Okay, I muted everybody because we are getting some feedback. So if you want to say something, unmute yourself. On the road, it got a lot of looks, head turners. And like I said, people actually crossing the street. When I stopped at a stoplight, the one guy was out in the middle of the street saying, asking if that was a Ferrari. So I think the design is something that they hit the nail on the head with this particular car.
You know, it's interesting.
Go
it's
ahead.
Interesting about the Corvette. Like I said, the guy asked if it's a Ferrari. And I'd be tempted to say only a Ferrari puts a bow tie on its logo. But I think, you know, the biggest thing is American drivers, while most of us are driving crossovers, SUVs of some sort, there's still that turn-your-head passion for a true kick-butt, tear-off-the-road sports car. You may not be able to afford it. It may not be practical for you. But doggone if it doesn't reach your soul and just make you want to have one and find a wide open piece of highway just to see what it's like. You know, like somewhere in Texas or Arizona where it's posted at 80 miles an hour and you just blast down the road. And, you know, that's where I see the Corvette really fitting in. And for those who do use it as a daily driver, obviously, you know, one would hope that it's garaged and that they don't live in a city where the streets are too tough, because that suspension can only take so much abuse before it starts falling apart.
Well, I just want to say that you are listening to Auto Network Reports, and we take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, you just heard Mr. Greg Morrison, Bumper to Bumper TV, Mr. Frank Washington, AboutThatCar.com chimed in, and Dave Bolt back from hanging out on the West Coast, TexGarage.com. That's TexGarage.com. Today's show is brought to you by Coupons, Offers, and Deals. This is the official launch of our new car buying service where you can sign up and get free offers from local car dealers. Go to couponsoffersanddeals.com. But anyway, moving right along, if you know an African-American male who's 6 years or older. That's the vaccine. It's 30 years or older. Please make sure he gets his PSA exam. It's that little prick that could possibly save his life. Greg, what are you in this week?
This week, I am fortunate enough to be driving the Genesis G70. It's crossover. And it's got a 3.5-liter V6 engine, lots of power, just this wonderful two-row vehicle that's very luxurious inside, handles wonderfully. Yesterday, I drove up into the North Georgia mountains with it just to stretch it out and get some seat time. And it was just delightful on the interstate and on the non-interstate roads where you had some twisties and turns. Handles extremely well with an all-wheel drive. price point on it was $64,000. Now, in our day of driving, we averaged about 25 miles to the gallon, which when you think about it, for a V6 engine that's turbocharged, that's not bad mileage at all. The handling was great. I had stopped to see a friend of mine who lives up in the mountains, and he comes out the door and he says, "Is that a Porsche?" No, oh, that's here not we a go. Porsche. It's a Genesis. And he was, and then when he looked at the price point on it, because I showed him the Monroney, he said, "That's really a great deal." Interior seats are just gorgeous. They use suede inserts and then leather outer pieces for the interior seats, and it's just comfortable. Everything's within a touch. You know, driver doesn't have to go far to find things. You can just reach out and touch it. The 8-speed transmission, oh my God. Oh my God. I just loved it, especially when I hit some twisty roads. I just left it in drive and it just worked its way through, and it found the right gear at the right time. Genesis continues in what I call the Korean tradition of offering a truckload of value at a very reasonable price. Had this come with a nameplate out of the Bavarian mountains or the Black Forest of Germany, probably looking at $30,000 more on a price point on it. But oh my God, it was a lot of fun and also functional. I had to go to the UPS store the other day and ship some boxes. Be able to flip down the back seat, throw about 5-6 boxes in there, no problem. Easy in, easy out, a great liftover point. And it's a vehicle that if I was in the market for that kind of vehicle, I would seriously consider making a purchase with this.
Great. Frank.
Well, first of all, they just started giving out press vehicles.
Okay.
So I got one yesterday. And it was a Lexus UX, what is it? UX 200, which is a crossover. It's Lexus's, what am I thinking? Entry level crossover. And although I've only had it a day, and it's cold as heck out here, and with that cold comes ice. So, you know, there's no whipping around the roads and stuff. But one of the things that struck me about the car is that it's well appointed. You know, heated steering wheel, heated seats, and when it's 20 degrees outside, that heat makes a difference. You know, I think, yeah, it's got a moonroof. It's got, you know, a digital interior. It handled well as near as you can tell. But like I said, just can't go speed. I think it's got the downside for me anyway, is that it has a CVT, but it's got a 4-cylinder engine. It's well appointed. A lot of features, you know, a nav system, satellite radio, all these kinds of different things. But the thing that really struck me is that when I, because I've got the Maroney, and the thing that really, really struck me was it was $42,000, which I didn't think was bad. You know, I thought it was, you know, very, very value oriented. And when you think of Lexus, you really don't think of value. Not that they overprice their vehicles, but you know they look at themselves as competing with the Germans, as you say. And I thought it was a very nicely priced vehicle, and it was well appointed.
The coattails of Frank with regard to the UX 200. I'm in another Lexus, the IS 500. The IS 500 is the Lexus intenders would drive, as opposed to the UX 200. These people wouldn't drive a UX 200 if you put a gun to their head. This is that Lexus. So anyway, it's the IS body shell, which we've known now for, God, at least a decade, as an IS 200, an IS 300, or an IS 350. The top of the model range has previously been only a 4-cylinder turbo or V6. This installs 5 liters, 472 horsepower of V8 under what is essentially that same hood in that same platform. It's a 3-series footprint with 472 horsepower. Typically, you'd only have to get yourself an M3 or M4 and spend $80,000 to $100,000 for that level of horsepower and performance. Lexus, again, speaking to value, offers it to you for between 56 and about 65. So this is an amazing amount of push from under the hood, a decent degree of refinement. What you have to overlook is that this is an architecture that's been around for about a decade. And there are things about it that are old school, aren't quite up to date in the manner that a newer product would be. But offsetting that is an urge and a little bit of an old school feel that if you like old school platforms, you'll enjoy a lot. So I'm quite high on it. I don't have 55 to 65 grand to spend on a new four-door sedan. But when these things are in the pre-owned market for roughly half to two-thirds of that, I think it'll be a very, very neat used car buy if, of course, we can live that long. So anyway, that's where I am this week.
Okay, I always ask that you visit the website of each one of the panelists, because as you can see and hear, we have our different opinions on cars that sometimes same cars that we drive. And that's just what I like about doing a show like this. We get an array of opinions on product, pricing. Sometimes we talk about what happens when you go to the dealer, how much time they take with you to spend that $40,000 or $50,000. But again, take the time to visit the website of each one of the panelists. And guys, we had a major event on the East Coast this week. I'm sure you probably heard about it. It was the snowstorm that backed up I-95 as far as some reports said 45 miles. Some people spent as much as 36 hours in their cars. And one of the things that kind of struck me was, we talk a lot about EVs. What do you guys think about people who were out there in EVs for maybe 18 to 19 hours?
There was an article in the Washington Post about an opinion piece the guy wrote about that event. And he noted that a Tesla owner was freaking out because the one thing with the EVs is the batteries lose their effectiveness the colder it gets. And that is a very valid concern. Battery technology, while in perfect conditions, yeah, you can get 200, 300, 400 miles, depending on the vehicle. But when it gets very cold, those batteries, you know, their life goes in half sometimes. And he raised a very valid point about, it's a good, you know, his thinking was, it's a good thing the majority of these vehicles weren't EVs, because most of them would have had to have been towed off the roads. And I think there's a message there for the OEMs that are moving toward EVs, that you really need to spend some time with your battery development so that it can stand sitting on in a traffic jam for hours at a time on a sub-freezing day like that, to make sure your batteries, you know, hold up their charge. At the same instance, one of the things anybody who's driven an EV will tell you is, in extreme, either extreme heat or extreme cold, don't run all of your devices in the car just to keep yourself from being bored. That tends to suck up your battery even more. And so, I mean, it was an object lesson there for the folks, for the brands that are looking to go full EV, and for the folks who are considering it, in that here's what happens when it gets very cold and you're sort of stuck in traffic. So, you know, plan ahead, or and also develop ahead, you know, with a system to weatherproof battery electric vehicles.
I read that same article, Greg. It was written by Charles Lane, and I thought he made some extremely good points. You've reiterated most of them. The thing I'd ask, and it's a larger question that maybe should get its own show, Roosevelt, but where is common sense in the administration of this interstate system? The Virginia Senator, Tim Kaine, was trapped for 27 hours in trying to make a drive from his Richmond home to D.C. to vote. And he gets back to D.C. and his response, of course, to 27 hours on the interstate is, well, we need to vote through this infrastructure plan. It could be three lanes or it could be 13. If you don't have a state official closing the road when it snows that much and that quickly, you're still going to have people on that road trapped for an entire day. I think we need more accountability. We need more common sense in government. And for the same reason that people were trapped for 27 hours on an interstate, we've got the Philadelphia Housing Authority and 13 people burning in a home that was obviously mismanaged by the city of Philadelphia. And here in Fairfax County, Virginia, we've got the schools closed despite the streets being completely clear 4 days after the snowstorm. So you got me started, Roosevelt, and that's all I have to say about that.
We have our political show coming up right after this one at 3:35.
And by God, I'll be there, Roosevelt. And by the way, can I quickly add, if I offended Frank with regard to the UX 200, I'm all about the UX 200 at $32,000. It's when it gets up to $42,000 that I start having this mental disconnect. And then I go off on this political tantrum as a result of it. So apologies to everyone, okay?
You know, it's interesting. All I can say is, one, that was a unique situation, you know, the storm being as bad as it was. And the other one is, I don't understand why consumers, who I also blame for the backup, once they heard that there was going to be a snowstorm, still made the decision to go out on an interstate that they could see was not being plowed. And didn't seem to make any adjustment to try and get off. I remember years ago, I was at the NADA show in New Orleans, the year that they had the snowstorm that did the same thing in Atlanta, where everybody was stuck on the interstate around Atlanta. And we were driving back from New Orleans, and we were on the interstate, and we could see the snow starting to come down. We listened to the radio. Yeah, there's a snowstorm coming. And they would tell you which way it was, which the direction it was coming, the amount of snowfall, the temperature dropping. And the first thing we started doing was looking for an hotel so we could pull off, because the interstate was getting worse and worse and worse. And a lot of people just said, well, it's not going to be as bad as we think it is. And
it's also the mentality of, oh, I got to get back to work, right? Yeah, I'm going to try to plow through anyway. Look, I would rather be late than be the late.
Yeah.
And, you know, too many folks insisted, well, I got to be there. No, you don't. Only thing you got to do in this life is die and pay taxes.
Well, you don't
have to pay taxes.
It's been a number of years since I lived in the Midwest, but I'm remembering everything Western Nebraska. If you had snowstorms impacting your interstate, people were far happier to spend 5, 6, 7 hours at a rest stop because the interstate was closed than they are spending 15, 16, 17 hours on the interstate in their cars. And the notion that you had no state troopers following up to see if these people had needs, the notion that you had no National Guard. I mean, I understand being January 6th that the National Guard can't show up in Washington, D.C., but presumably they can show up near Richmond, Virginia. And so anyway, it just, as you suggest, Roosevelt, it was a compilation of things, but you'd hope our government would have institutional perspective to minimize the damage rather than the damage exploding.
Right.
And I'm not running for anything.
He rides a bike, folks. He's biking for something. Dave bikes for. Dave doesn't run.
Yeah.
But back to EVs, we have probably maybe what, 10, 15 new EVs coming out in the next 6 months to a year. And a lot of them are going to have better batteries, like Greg was saying, have better battery management. As a matter of fact, I just read where one company now is testing a battery that they literally drove 752 miles on a charge. Now, I don't know what that would equate to under conditions like we were talking about, under extreme cold, or as Dave mentioned, under extreme heat. What happens to the life of the battery. And the other thing is, with EVs going to at some point really populate the highway, I think we're going to see larger EVs on the highway, like Silverado's coming out with the big truck. And I think we're going to be going back to bigger and bigger vehicles out there because you don't have the combustion engine that's creating all the smog and polluting the air that they're talking about. And the price of cars, starting with EVs, are not cheap, even though the NX that Frank was talking about, the UX rather, $42,000, that is a lot of money. $42,000 is a lot of money. But I'm leading up to an article that I read earlier today talking about the price of cars. I don't know where these people were living or what they were smoking, but they were talking about people can't afford cars now. They have this pent-up demand, and they're basing a lot of that on the government subsidy that people got for, what, a year or less than a year. It's like they were able to bank all that money. People think that, you know, you got that $300 or $400 a month or a week check, and people just banked it. People were using that money to pay to live and pay other expenses. I don't think they were banking it to buy a new automobile, but they made it seem like, oh, people can't afford these very expensive cars. That's not going to be a problem in 2022 when the new cars come out and we have these outrageous Monronis. What do you guys think about cost of cars and how we're going to finance them, or who can buy them?
I think we all need to be careful about speaking about today like it was yesterday. There was a time when people thought that 48-month notes, 62-month notes, was outrageous. I'm not saying it's the smart thing to do. What I'm saying is there will be people who pay these really large car notes and have these large financing packages to buy these vehicles. Roosevelt, let's not forget about leasing. You can lease far more expensive vehicles than you have to finance. So there are all sorts of stuff. The point of it is if the car buying public wants it, the car buying public will find a way to get it in their driveway. It's real simple. As yet, I'll put it, I don't see the ceiling yet that will, get people to say, oh, no, I can't afford that. I mean, there will be some, but just, as a glass ceiling, that just stops it, I don't see it.
I remember our friend, the late Warren Brown, wrote a column about a year before he passed. And Warren noted that the average new car price at that time was around $35,000. And he challenged, do we really need to spend $35,000 on a car considering what wages were at that time, what wages and salaries are? So, it's a question of, as Frank says, you can lease more car than you can buy for the same price. And the other side of it is people are keeping cars a lot longer. It's not like they're turning them over every 5 years. I've got neighbors around here who are driving 8-9-year-old vehicles and are perfectly happy with them. So, when you decide to take the plunge into a newer vehicle to get into the new technology, a growing number of folks are going to the lease market as a way to just say, okay, I've got this vehicle, I've got the technology and all the safety stuff I want, but I'm not stuck with a 7-year note. And in reality, the average person, if you get 15,000 miles a year allowance, unless you're a salesman, you're not doing 15,000 miles a year. You may be doing about 9,000, 10,000. With one or two road trips in between. So, it depends on what your needs are. And the hard reality of it is, do you want to own this vehicle after 3 or 4 years, considering that the technology is changing so fast that literally it's outdated a year after you take it off the showroom floor?
I would blend with what Greg was suggesting with my personal experience on our driveway. We've got an 2011 Subaru, that my son drives, bought from us. In our garage, we've got an 06 Grand Cherokee. To be sure, it has only 115,000 miles because I get press cars. But still, both obviously have been long paid for. To my way of thinking, you buy the best car that you can, get it paid off, and then drive the wheels off of it, maintaining it appropriately, and it will last you a good decade longer after the payments. If you want to bite off more car than you can buy, lease it, as you're suggesting, Greg, but then buy it at the end of that lease term as your used car and not someone else's. It's the used car you know. It's the used car that you've watched depreciate. And it's the used car that presumably, if you want to buy it, you can have faith in owning it. Make a car purchase based on a decade's degree of usage or period of time. And I think you'll find most things are affordable if you keep it within that context. You don't buy, typically, you can't buy more house than you can afford because the lenders won't let you. The difference in car buying, the car dealers are delighted for you to buy more than you need because they make more money in you doing so. If you would look at it in the same way that your mortgage lender would look at it, you'll get a pretty good idea of what you can afford and what you truly need.
Great. Okay. I want to thank you all for watching Auto Network Reports Live. For those of you, I want to thank you who are watching the replay on demand, and you can also check out our Auto Network Reports podcast on most of the podcasting websites. We've now been approved for most of those, and this show, segments of it, will be on the podcast. And as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Buckle up. Don't text and drive. Buckle up. Don't stream and drive. And what was the other one we were going to have to come up with? Buckle up. Don't. And play games and drive. I guess that was.
But it should be added, Roosevelt, that if you're on I-95 for 24 hours, you can do all of that.
Game.
Yeah, right.
Unless you're in a Tesla.
Oh, I must say, Tesla did reverse their decision to activate that screen where you could play games while the car was moving. They heard the show and they immediately turned that system off. So now you can't, while the car is moving, you can't play games on the front screen in the new Tesla. So thank you guys for taking the time.
Thanks, Roosevelt.
See you next time.
You got it.